I am absolutely saddened by the number of developers who are plagued by JavaScript fatigue. Nah, who am I kidding? I don't actually care. But it is kind of interesting to see more developers catch this disease. So let's talk about it.
Now, half of you have no idea what I'm talking about. So let's go over some of the symptoms of JavaScript fatigue.
Okay, so here is a bowl of salt. This is the world. The world is full of salt, especially on the internet and especially on Twitter. See this? This is you. You don't start with any salt, but you slowly accumulate it by proximity. And eventually, you start getting some symptoms. The first one you may notice is bitterness. And that's bitterness whenever anyone brings up a new technology or a new framework, and instead of rejoicing, you say, "Ugh, another JavaScript framework?" And you get your first spoonful of salt. Symptom number two is feeling overwhelmed all the time by the sheer amount of technologies that you need to know to really do anything. This is specifically in the front-end world, where it feels like there are new libraries coming out all the time and new updates, and you feel like it's very hard to stay on top of things. Symptom number three is the fear of missing out whenever a new technology comes out and you feel like, oh, I gotta use it. All my friends are using it, or I feel like I'm going to miss out on all the cool benefits you get from using it. If I just stick here and use this thing I've been using, I'm gonna miss out. And symptom number four is the fear of feeling obsolete, or that your skill set is just being outdated all the time. And that can come back to feelings of being overwhelmed, and you feel like you just learned this tool and now it's obsolete and you have to go learn another one, and you feel like you're in a rat race. Now, in very severe cases, we find that there is a fifth symptom where even the mentioning of the word JavaScript can just bring your body to complete shudders. And this is pretty much the most extreme case, and you're gonna wanna guard against this. Now, lucky for you, in today's video, I have some pro tips for you. You see this? This is me. I'm gonna help you dissolve some of your salt, but depending on how coarse your salt is, it may take a different amount of time to dissolve. So let's dig in.
So there's a few things that I do to avoid fatigue. The first is a tactic which I call lazy evaluation, which is basically the same thing that you do when you code and you don't want to load everything all at once, right? So like when you go to Facebook.com, they don't load all of the profiles in their database. They wait until you navigate to that page and then they load the data for it. And of course, the reason they do that is you may not even visit some of those pages, so why load the data for them? And you know, they also just have way too much data. Well, I take the same approach when I'm tackling new things to learn or when I'm trying to build things. So I don't just learn all the technologies that I'm gonna need to build something. I wait until I actually need it for that time in the project, all right? So let me give you a concrete example of that. So Webpack and Babel are two popular front-end technologies that you probably expect most front-end engineers to know about. Well, those were two, I guess you call them libraries or frameworks or projects, which I just chose not to learn at all, basically. And the reason why I did that was I really didn't need them to get something working. So for example, what I did instead is I just used a boilerplate that made a Webpack config and a Babel config for me, and I didn't even have to think about it or configure that stuff for myself. Now, it's kind of funny when people ask me about it now, because they're like, "Hey Ben, can you help me with my Webpack config?" And I'm kind of just like, "Sorry pal, I don't even know Webpack." I just never configure my own Webpack stuff. I just use whatever the boilerplate that I'm using config does for me. And I think this approach is very nice when there's a ton of tools that you need to know and they're kind of in your way to start learning and start building stuff. And so with this lazy evaluation thing, I basically wait to actually, you know, learn these technologies until I actually need to. And it turns out I never really needed to know Webpack. Now, there may get to a point where for a project, the configuration that comes with the boilerplate is not enough, and I need to actually go in there and start tweaking stuff. And so in that point in time, I would actually spend the time to, you know, go through and learn Webpack to configure it correctly for this particular project. But basically, I do that for every single technology that I need for something. I ask myself, is there anything I can do to avoid using this or using something that I already know? If the answer is yes, then I just wait and I use either a boilerplate or something that can deal with that tool for me until I actually get around to actually needing it. All right, so here is the other thing that you can do to prevent yourself from self-destructing, basically. You need to stop hopping around to different things. I see far too many newbie developers start with Ruby on Rails, and then they're like, I see people with, you know, getting making more money doing Node.js. So then they switch over to Node.js, and they're like, oh wait, now I see people making more money with Golang, and they switch to that, oh wait, Rust now. And you're basically just keep hopping languages and frameworks, and you're basically killing yourself doing that. I think it's a complete waste of time to keep hopping like that. And the other thing is when you pick something, you try learning way too much all at once. So not only are you learning Node.js right now, but you're also trying to learn TypeScript and GraphQL and React.js all at the same time. And you're basically screwing yourself trying to learn way too many things. Now that might sound complete crazy coming from me because I use all that stuff, but I'm really part of the problem. And so is your coworker who's doing all kinds of cool stuff and he has, you know, 5 different languages and frameworks under his belt. And you're like, wow, I have to learn all that stuff to be equal to him, right? Well, here's the thing. So you came in and you saw, you know, this person at a specific snapshot of their development career, right? So you see the stuff that I'm using and you're like, I have to learn all that stuff. But I did not just, you know, learn all this stuff all at once and try to, in parallel, just, you know, do all that stuff. It's just a terrible way to go about learning it. Instead, let me tell you exactly how I went across learning each one of those things, all right? So I started with just simply learning React by itself. I did make the mistake of mixing it with Redux and learning Redux and React at the same time. But I was, you know, specifically focused on just that framework. And then after I felt like I had a good grip on it, I switched over to learn some REST stuff, some API, some Node.js backend, and I learned Feathers. I happened to pick Feathers. I don't even remember why I picked it, but I think it was I think it's better to just go and pick something than it is to dwell on picking the perfect framework to get started with. Because once you master one of these things, once I get really good at Feathers or I get really good at React.js, it makes it very easy for me to transition from React to Angular or Angular to Vue or whatever front-end framework I want. I can learn it very quickly when I'm very good at one of them. And so that's the problem people have is they see me or they see someone else and they're like, how do you learn it so quickly? It's because once you're really good at one thing, learning that next thing that's exactly like it, but you know, different syntax is super easy. It's whenever you learn your first programming language, it was super hard. The next one was way easier. This is the exact same thing. And so once I've mastered and got good at Feathers and learning backend stuff, making that transition to say using Django or using Golang and choosing a different backend language, but doing basically the same thing, it's not that hard. It's not too bad. All right, so with that said, after I did that, I then layered on GraphQL on top of it and started learning GraphQL. So once I felt like I was feeling confident with GraphQL and enjoying it, I was like, TypeScript looks interesting. Let's give that a try. Turns out I really liked it. Started integrating stuff in. and started then, you know, using TypeScript and GraphQL together and looking for, you know, a good integration between the two, because I was having problems with, you know, the types and writing them twice. So then I stumble into stuff like TypeGraphQL and all the GraphQL frameworks. And so I slowly built up the number of technologies and libraries that I'm using. And so you're just seeing me at the end of the road where I've kind of started to finalize what my stack is and the technologies that I use. And you should not be trying to learn all these things all at once. In my opinion, the approach that I took, that was very successful for me, was to just focus that one at a time, become an expert in that little, you know, niche or that little framework, and then go from there. So when you take this approach, whenever you're feeling overwhelmed, it's very easy to just, you know, go back a little bit. All right, let's spend even more time on Feathers, or spend even more time on React, and just brush up my skills, get stronger at it, build more stuff with it. And then when I'm feeling, you know, confident in that, let's go start learning some more stuff again. And if you're wondering how to actually get good at each one of these things before you move on to the next thing, you should just be you should be building projects with them and just build more and more projects. And that's going to be the fastest way to get your skills up in a particular framework or library or whatever you're using. So yeah, using a combination of those two things, I don't feel JavaScript fatigue at all.